Welcome, good evening, welcome, thank you for being here. Good evening again from Teruta and I, Nina Bassoli. We are very, very pleased tonight to host a very special guest with his firm office, Office Kerstengast David Van Severen, from since 20 years more or less, maybe more. They do such a interesting and deep work in both research and practice. And I think that this peculiar combination between a deep research that moves from exhibitions and researches and academic commitment, and the very pragmatic work on the other side, on the field of architecture in several places in Europe and in the world, they really give a very important and interesting reference for all of us, and all of us as architects and researchers. So I don't want to make a biography, but just to be very grateful and thank you very much, Kerstengast, for being here with us tonight. And I leave you the floor. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Good. Well, thank you. Thank you, Nina, also for the invite. Thank you for having us here. I hope you can all hear me. Yes. So, is there a way? Is there something? Here it is. Okay. Thank you. So, well, in the context here this late afternoon about, I would dare to say, periphery, I thought it was important from our perspective as an office, but indeed, as has been just mentioned, also in, to a certain extent as a unit who always tries to investigate, say, the raison d'être of architecture, to deal with periphery in an extremely, I would dare to say, simple but perhaps profound way. That's why I called the lecture Dealing with Everything. So, everything, and I hope this works, but it doesn't. Should I do it here? Anybody knows how this works? No? Oh yeah, it works. Yeah, I have to do like that. Okay. Okay, now it works. So, everything, of course, here, as you can see, and I use it as a background for the title, is this Tutto work by Alighiero Boetti, which had been, I would say, compagnon de route for quite many years, the last 4 years when we were working in Mendrisio, working on exactly this territory. And to me, this territory is exemplary. It's far from the only place in the world, but since we're here between, say, Milan and Mendrisio, we thought in the last few years it was an important place as an example of, well, call it periphery, but perhaps from our perspective, call it everything. So this and that are the same. So for us, I would dare to say, after with our friends at San Rocco, we once declared that the distinction between the city and the countryside is no longer where we were far from the first, the even covered field, as we were talking about. Since then, I think we, to a certain extent, gave up working in the city proper or working in the periphery proper, but just simply accepting that in our current condition, this is where we are. So this is where we have been busy with working, and these are but a few examples in the studios in the last semesters. Which then resulted in various investigations on figures of energy and storage and habitation and combinations of that, asking ourselves where, whether it is in Bellinzona, in Alto Milanese, or any of these places around, one has to understand how we could insert an idea of urbanity, because ultimately these places are all urban and are all not. So that strange, I would dare to say, coincidence had been since, say, 2018, our continuous focus of investigation. So this dealing with everything is ongoing, and I believe is the core of our current architectural practice. It is to say that we feel the only way to still do projects is to try to understand that in this total mess, where everything is more or less equal, like you would see in this Boëti artwork, one has to find strategies to carve out special places, to carve out spaces which are, to a certain extent, shared. Now, in parallel to this, we also made, a few years ago, this book on Aldo Rossi's, Urban Fact, which is, of course, you could say, paraphrasing his arguments of his 1966 Architecture of the City, but trying to understand that book not so much as a book about the city, but a book about the periphery. So for us, what was important is, when we were making this book, is not so much to understand the writing of Rossi and try to desperately find architecture, perhaps easily in the 80s or after that, which to one or another way would illustrate that idea of repairing the city proper, but rather understanding that in the immediate aftermath of that book, and after, the introduction of Fatto Urbano, or Urban Fact, Rossi was essentially working in the periphery, desperately trying to make clusters, figures, and ideas of buildings which would bring a microscopic idea of urbanity. So for us, and that's why I wanted to share these two elements of the way we have been working with our students and our team in the last couple of years, this is, I would say, our own primer. So here you see pictures of Stefano Graziani, of these very buildings, where you see that the strange, I would say, precise geometries of, for example, the Faianola School, in reality, of course, are twisted by the way you kind of approach the building, where one enters, and to what extent the building itself, in all its pure geometry, mediates with the context in which it consciously inhabits. And I think that's important. It's important for us to understand that these projects always were like that. They are not like this today, and they were better in the past. No, these projects always were, in our opinion, a kind of negotiation between an architectural desire and a desire for a certain idea of collectivity and collective form and a kind of shared figure in a world itself which is just everything. So this as some kind of, I would say, introduction. Now, with these elements, looking at the periphery, having Boëti in the back of our mind, looking at examples from the 70s and 80s, like here Rossi, but there's others, but very much operating in the same field. I thought it was interesting to share with you a couple of projects of the office, which in a way try to deal with similar topics, but for which I would dare to say post Urban Fact, we gradually try to develop some kind of moniker, some kind of term. That term is a big house. Now, what is a big house? You could say a big house is what you just saw in this beautiful school by Rossi. I personally think one of his masterpieces, if not the masterpiece. A big house is what you see in these desperate attempts to make clusters, big and small, of livable units, of points of reference in the Alto Milanese, or in Bellinzona, in the leftover places, or simply everywhere where one feels there is a need for some kind of idea of urbanity. But a big house, I think, is also some kind of collective building, a kind of a big house, not a small house, but which understands that the core of its raison d'être is that it has thresholds, that it's not a big glass box, that it's not some kind of building of which the evident position it has is explained by its position in the city. No, it's a building which itself needs to kind of acquire meaning in its figure and needs to acquire meaning in the way it stands in the field, between everything. Now, let me give a few examples. So this, of course, is work from the office. Perhaps one of the simplest arguments or the simplest ideas or the simplest ways to explain the big house is, strangely enough, this project in the Arabic world. So this is a project, one of the few projects we did in Bahrain. So here you see context, which I think is fantastic. So this place, this spot as you see here, is where that project is a building we call typically the Dar. It's one of the two Dars we built in Bahrain. Reality is, of course, that the word Dar in Arabic means house, and it's not a house. But I come back to that. At the same time, you see this is Rifa. Very often when you show these projects, we show the other one, the one in Mukharak. Why? Because it was finished much earlier, and this Rifa Dar is only finished since a year or so. So it's the smallest one, and it's the one which carries maybe the most recognizable collage. So here we are in, well, you could say, a kind of urbanity, which is very sandy, not very high, 10 meters at max, but most of it only one floor. It's kind of more or less organically grown, and it's endlessly transforming. So when we were working on this place, and we were asked to deal with that little, yellow house you see here, we realized we had to, on the one hand, save, I would say, restore that little house, and it is a house, it's a dar indeed, and turn it into a more, I would say, public or collective endeavor, a collective building. Why? Because this place, this dar, is essentially a place which has its a kind of significance because of what happens inside of that house. That house, like two, three others in Bahrain, is a house which has been populated for many years by groups of men who play this kind of music or something similar to music, which they hit earthen bottles, they clap, they sing. And they do that because they're part of a tradition which is slowly fading, which is that they were descendants of pearl fishermen. And these pearl fishermen, in the 1930s, they were on boats in the Gulf fishing for pearls. And when they were fishing for pearls, they made this music, you know, and they to keep the rhythm, to keep awake, to be on these boats for many days. Now, pearl fishing had been, digging for oil had basically destroyed pearl fishing. Artificial pearls have destroyed pearl fishing. So the result is that 2020, 2018, when we started this project, there is no pearl fishing left. But there is this ephemeral tradition. And this tradition is in a way private. I mean, it's a group of guys, they do that, they give it father to son, and so it kind of survives. So when the Ministry of Culture asked us to kind of transform this house, the one I just showed here, it had a wall in the middle, we thought it was interesting, and also to make it more public, to make it in a sense more accessible, we thought it was interesting, and here on the left you see that house, to keep the house as it is, to take away the wall, to restore the court. I think here on the right side, you understand a little bit what was our fascination, if I dig in our own work. And not so much transform it by adding, but building a little building next to it. Now, that building next to it is what you could see here in the very beginning, is something which you could call a mejles. If a dar is a house, a mejles is something like, a public shared room. You see it here also in some different examples. So where a sitting place where the community would gather. So we thought it was important in front of this house to put a public house, and that public house should share in many ways the features of that house, but it shouldn't be rooms around a court, but it should be a set of rooms stacked on top of each other. So that there was a kind of a decreased accessibility from bottom to top. So I would dare to say here that very little building which has its height. Why? Because that's the maximum height of the current, I would say, urban rules, which means that all houses which are demolished are typically raised to that height. And we thought it was important to give it importance to raise it to that height too. But since it has such a small footprint, it becomes a very small, almost iconic building. So here, the Mejles as an answer to the Dar, and to a certain extent, our first big house. I mean, it's a house which is a set of rooms. You see them here. I don't go fully into detail. I think I explained it in many other occasions. So there's a room on top of a room on top of a room. The rooms are somehow all the same. There's a set of columns, as you can see here, which carry the building. You see it also in the model picture. Not all columns are structural. Some are ducts. And then all the machines which are necessary, like a toilet, but also an airco, are pushed outside and made visible. Why did we do that? Because we wanted to make the house, in a way, as simple as possible, closable on the inside, but also with cross ventilation to make it as simple, ventilatable as possible. Of course, in winter, in autumn, in spring it works, in summer no way. I mean, it's so hot, a bit like here today. I mean, you need a machine, I guess. So this as an introduction of a big house. So here you see a picture by Bas, a very recent one. So you see the Dar here on the left, the real Dar, where these guys still gather together in private, in their own court, and you see this place, which is this Mejles-like place, that one, as you might have seen it in the past, and here, Dar and Mejles. So here you see that it opens, and when it opens, it becomes this kind of place of interaction. So the reason why I wanted to start with this is that in the most simplistic, but nevertheless, I would dare to think, clear way, it shows this idea of turning a house into a big house and realizing it's not about size. The house next door, the Dar, is perhaps even bigger than the Mejles. The Mejles is taller, but it's a big house in that it desires to be shared. It desires to be public in some sense, and hence it protects the existing house which we renovated. So if we take this idea of a house of another size as an object in the middle of, let's say, the everything, and we move back to Belgium, then we come here. So here you see that. This is Sint Maartenslatem. But again, as you see, Sint Maartenslatem would feel like a city. It is a small city. But it's, again, of course, a place somewhere between what is a lot of pavilionaire, big houses, but they're all houses. A bit of green. It's a very green neighborhood. It's actually a very rich neighborhood. The neighborhood is so rich because there's very low taxes. Because there's very low taxes, there's no money in the urban city government. As a result, they can't afford their library. So this is a bit the irony of the case, of course. So you have an area which is extremely rich, but in a sense has no public infrastructure. So it took them, I think, 15 years to gather together a kind of coalition between the local school, a kind of culture club, and the library to make a new library. So it was a competition which we won, and we made this building which you see here below. So I guess here what was important for us is to deal with this kind of house-like environment, as you can see here. And this Dan Graham, of course, very famous, cutting open a kind of suburban house. But perhaps in opposition to what Graham does there, which is, in a way, making everything visible, we believe that it was important because all these houses are already this kind of mise-en-scene of, their own riches, with the car in front and all the other tropes of what they could acquire, that this library, which wanted to be deeply collective, so to speak, is in everything the opposite. The center of the library is the most public space. This is, you see it here, the courtyard here and there. And the facade or the perimeter of the library is the most enclosed one. So the library is, in a sense, a big patio surrounded by an almost completely closed wall. So here you see that again. So you see the context, you see it better. You see these big houses, and you see that this library, although a big house itself, is hardly larger than the houses surrounding it. Here below you see the school, which provided us with the immediate context. So there's a couple of classrooms of the school for special courses in that library. There's even a reading room, and then there's a big patio. So here you see, in a way, these are the competition collages. The desire here was to make a building which is, like I showed just before, entirely closed and yet entirely shared, entirely public, where the moment you're inside, in this library garden, if you want, you're surrounded by the library and its books. So here you see a set of models. You here and there find back Matt Mullican references, which is somebody we like a lot. So in this sense, Matt Mullican's model for a house is quite telling, with the center, which is the world framed, as the ones who saw here his show in Bicocca probably still remember. The world framed is, in that sense, this yellow space, is a place, the court, in the center of this very simple round object. So here you see the library in construction. You see it here on the left. This is a picture very, very recently taken. An artwork of Richard Venlet, which we included. And for the rest, you see, well, the real plans, some in-between plans, and the desire to make this object, which is almost dome-like. For that reason, the McBride work is here. So here you see the plan. You see, in a way, the square and the circle. You see the quarter pizza slice, so to speak, the two triangles with the infrastructure, the librarian room, the shared room with only three windows towards the school, the entrance, no windows, and the court, and then in a way a building built by books. Now, to make this building built by books was of course a nightmare, because in a sense you try to build a building made as a shelf. So a shelf has a kind of dimension, a precision, which is typical for furniture. A building does not have, a roof does not have, so it took us 2.5 years to get there, but finally it's almost finished, as you can see. Here you see the library, its structure, the ceiling is there, the court is there, you see the section here, and you see the construction site a few weeks ago. I think these are pictures from yesterday, so you see it appearing. They are not great pictures, no bus around, but you also see somehow a little bit the scale. So you see that the shelves start to be installed. So that's the library as it is. So the library, as I said in the beginning, as a big house. So a house where I would dare to think the core of it, its public functioning, is that the moment you enter it, you're somewhere else. I mean, and you're only in your world without anything of the clutter of everything surrounding you. So if we move on and we move to Brussels, you have here a building which is, you could argue, weirdly included in our collection of big houses tonight or this afternoon. This is a brewery building. It's a very simple building. It's an industrial building. And again, it's a building which is nor in the city or in the periphery. So, of course, maybe in another context, when you would talk about cities, you would say, ah, this building is built in Brussels. But I think here, starting with Tutto and everything, as I think you can easily agree with me, this spot at the canal, somewhere between what is the leftover of the boxes and the industrial buildings of the canal, towards the south of Brussels, the center is far more up, next to Anderlecht, in a place which is in deep and fast transformation. It's even in terms of program an interesting one. That is, on the one hand, it's a building where the brewers, which now are using it, wanted to belong to these buildings in the canal, want maybe in the future to use the canal again as a mode of transport. At the same time, and of course trying to get lots of subsidy for the kind of revitalization of this area, at the same time it's a deeply urban, in a way, project, because it's a tasting room, it's a beer garden, it's a kind of a set of spaces, perhaps the first group of more or less shared spaces in this whole slightly impoverished neighborhood. So here, the way the building got to its, I'd say, figure or appearance was, I think, the desire from our side to make an extremely simple building, because at the end it's a brewery, it's just machines, but to give that building almost like a flag. So was it possible to make a flag and a building? Was it possible to make a tent and a building? Was it possible to make this thing look like a flag without it being a flag? I think that has always been somehow our fascination. And you build a building, you don't make it out of textile, not easily. It's an industrial building. It's just extremely simple and cheap materials. But at the same time, this kind of negotiation with its appearance, but at the same time, without denying its, I would say, cultural heritage, in which I mean that industry of brewing today, which is a deeply hipster industry, if I can say that, is of course some kind of, I would say, embraces a nostalgia for industrial production. So in a sense, this kind of accumulation of vats collected in a building, the way the vats are treated, the way you see the process, all these things, in some sense, what they do is that they embrace and to a certain extent adore the kind of mise-en-scene of things which were until recently extremely, industrial and not necessarily of any value. So here, the Becher one, I think the Pomona temple with the tent-like structure on the top, and then the set of perspectives which try to kind of make the point. So here you see how that building came about. It was first a box, then it became a lozenge. It was in a way, and it has been in the way until the very end. It's just a very simple perimeter made out of prefab concrete plates with a steel structure. And inside there's a set of tables which organize the process. So the collages of the competition, a view from afar, and a few pictures of how the building came about. So it's a building where the corrugated steel roof, which is of course used for its strength, it's very simple, going from beam to beam, makes the flag or makes the tent, where the concrete paneling makes the perimeter, and all the tables are made with round steel columns with its plates. So I think a lot here is searching for definitions of elements. So it's only how choosing the round column as opposed to a rectangular column, painting the steel columns which are part of the structure of the perimeter as gray as the concrete, and then of course going for these colors, which as you can see here have a strange reminiscence of the color scheme of the Brussels Beer Project, because that's the client that will make each of these function as the way they would like to function. So here you see a few more pictures, the floor, the ceiling, and the machinery. Now, why I like to show this project is that although it's an industrial building, and although it's even a building one can hardly access, it is with this very strange large roof, which, well, works as its own identity, but in overhang also works as a very specific place, that the building, of course, starts to behave on a, you could say, urban level as in its own context. So you see that here on the one hand and how the building presents itself. But you see it also here, and I don't think I have a picture of the back where the long roof makes some kind of beer garden in the neighborhood. Now if you move on to this project, which is a crematorium, again we look at the context and you see to a certain extent that one of, I would dare to say, our most important public buildings in our kind of contemporary kind of society, which is, at least in Belgium, I think 60% of the people are nowadays cremated when they die, is a building of which people have an extreme ambivalence. So replacing at least partly the function of a church, but replacing that for people with many different belief systems or embracing many different belief systems and convictions, it is a building which is at the same time hyper-pragmatic as it is, desperately looking for some kind of shared symbolism. At the same time, it's also a building which I believe, because people have a very ambivalent relationship with burning bodies, so to speak, that, like they did, by the way, with cemeteries in the past, they typically push outside. So the outside of Ostende is here. Mm. So it's the polders. What's interesting about this aerial view is that Ostende is here, and the next village is here, and then there's another one there. And of course, as a kind of big intercommunale, they decided to do this crematorium together, so they had a good argument to build it somewhere here in the polders. At the same time, it's a building which, despite its extreme importance, it's somehow lost in space. So it's as much lost in space as the big boxes here next to the highway. At the same time, it's not exactly there. So this as a first problem. At the same time, as a building, it has to look for some kind of presence. So how do you deal with the problem of representation of a building with such, metaphoric magnitude? So together with Richard Venlet, what we came up with is to make a building as a gigantic table, you could say. The table, or the tableau, as you can see here, is tilted. It's tilted for a pragmatic reason, but it's also tilted to be able to make some kind of nature morte, to have a fifth facade, which is in a way the most important facade, which is that what makes the building in some way. That has again very pragmatic reasons, that is that there's a chimney to be integrated and light cupolas and stuff like that. A chimney of which, by the way, in Belgium at least, one cannot see it. It is not supposed to have smoke. It's not supposed to have a figure of the chimney. So you have to resolve a set of technical issues which are essentially exercises in disguise. So all this together brought us to this first and then final composition of a kind of big tableau, nature morte, still life, which had to deal with exactly that. So perhaps standing in for all the symbolism typically related to buildings in the past where similar actions happened. So you see that we were looking for a set, through a set of exercises, to what now exactly would be this set of rooms which will make this crematorium. We were working with this idea of a still life as a reference. And at a certain point, we came with this idea of this tilted roof, which would make the gesture visible, but which would also, and I hope I have it here somewhere, yeah, here in the section, make the machines work better. So you have a building which is very intimate. It's only 2.20 meters, 2.30 meters. It all the time changes, of course, in the main entrance area, so here. And it's actually very high. It's 9 meters in the back, where the machines are, the big ovens are, and also all the tubing, that's not this part of the section, but that's that, which is needed to clean the air so before it comes out. So in a way, you have a big box on the one hand, but at the same time, you have, in a way, a gigantic table which collects a set of rooms. I think another interesting feature, we believe, of a big house as a public building in the periphery, and this set of rooms, this set of spaces, make a kind of sequence of decreasing accessibility. So from the two waiting rooms to the two main halls to the shared kind of corridor which allows these halls to be combined, always through these thicker or thinner walls, so to speak, to the part where in fact only 2-3 members of the family can enter, where the ovens are, and the part which actually is totally inaccessible by people. So you have this sequence of walls which organizes levels of accessibility, and you have this kind of relationship with the polders, because these polders are, of course, as you know, artificial landscapes. So here we work together with Bas Smets to understand that these polders are essentially constructed landscape, which typically have these rabats of trees which keep the water out and negotiate the wind. So the building is also oriented that way, that the moment you finally enter it, you, in a way, only look out in these far views. So here you see it built, a picture by Bas. You see that the landscape is still under construction in this thing. I think the first picture shows a more recent version. And you see this set of walls which organize these different levels of accessibility. See the space inside. So this is one of the two main rooms. And that's the other one, actually, with the roof lights. And here you see it from the back. So if I move on, I think there's two more projects to go, so I hope you're not bored yet. Another house. It's a very big house, you could say, but I find it here interesting to stretch the definition. So as I said, I share this title, A Big House. I shared the context, everything. And now the question is, why and how do each of these projects relate to that? So, I mean, here we are in Switzerland. We're in the campus of the EPFL and the UNIL. So the UNIL is here and the EPFL is there. You have the learning center, which we all know. But more important for me, at least in this conversation, is the pavillonaire. So you have all these small houses. I mean, we always have the tendency to idealize Switzerland, but Switzerland is as bad as everywhere else in the world. I mean, they have mountains here, but they're even France, so don't worry. I mean, so in a sense, this context, Lausanne, but not Lausanne. I mean, Morges, but not Morges. It's nowhere, in a sense. It's like just many, many things with gigantic clusters of educational facilities and a desire, of course, to develop the last bit here of at least the EPFL next to the UNIL. Now, our project is even stranger to that. Why? Because it's a building for the National Radio and Television, which has nothing to do with EPFL, which is here, nor with the UNIL there, nor with the pavillonaire. So it's a building which has been invited to inhabit this area. So when we made the project, and here I think I combined a couple of views of the building in its very first iteration, early versions in the competition, very early idea which we made to be even accepted as a candidate, so literally cutting a non-stop plan and say, is this not the project, to the iterations of the final competition entry, and also I think an important reference for us in this cluster as a big house, as a kind of a modernist idea, one of the many Sinan clusters, but this most beautifully, the Suleimani complex, which is in a way this set of buildings, which is in a way a city on its own, you know, a city on its own where the mosque, the court in front, the caravanserai, the different schools all together make in a way almost a campus on its own as a figure, I called it in another occasion, like Ottoman urbanism imposed in a site and looking or changing the whole context with one gesture. So we believe that was, in a sense, the task of the building. Why? Because it's the only real public building, it's a public radio and television in this kind of course, polytechnic public university, but which have their own rules and their own ways of dealing with their own space. So was it possible with this one building to, on the one hand, organize working, which you see here, the field organized by big boxes where other things can happen, so work on a table as opposed to work in a studio of different sizes? And is it also possible to organize this kind of hinge between the different parts of educational facilities between EPFL and UNIL? So here again you see these different versions, which I like, because I believe another feature of a big house is that a big house has a form which is so clear that all its versions of the form, all its dimensions which change, are such that the form somehow remains the same. So I think here that's very, very clear with this project. From 12, 14, 15, 19, 14, 20, this is the final building as we are building it now. All of these versions of the building are entirely different buildings, are completely redesigned, but what they share, I mean, say this one and that one, is that there are four boxes where a lot of things can happen which cannot happen in the field. So this idea that you have a field where a certain kind of work with northern light, with sheds, can happen, and that all kind of other things can happen in the box, I mean, that has remained. And I think that's very interesting for us. That is that if we are dealing with the periphery, as we have been discussing already, and I think the Dar, I only showed you the small Dar, the so-called Mejles-like Dar, is the same as the big Dar in Mukharak, but both, in some sense, are totally different in their dimensions. So here, the same is happening, I think. So here you see the building as it is now currently under construction. I think it's a picture from the last week, so it's quite far. And you see also that, in a sense, as a world on its own, it tries to reorganize the complete environment. So you see it here. And here are a few pictures of bus from last year, which I think show clearer because he's of course has a better eye, and they're not kind of snapshots. This I would say distinction between field and box, émergence as we call it in Lausanne. So you see it here. You see it here. So you see also that, of course, I didn't go into that in this context. I think it's not important. It's important for the project is that how these boxes carry the field and how then, in a way, all the spatial dividers are these beams which keep it up, but at the same time also kind of obliterate the necessity to do any other spatial organization in the building. It almost happened automatically. Mm-hmm. So to finish, going back to Belgium, I wanted to share this big house, a very strange, in a way, very, well, it's not very strange, I think it's even very contemporary building in a sense. Here we are in Antwerp, but the center of Antwerp is somewhere here, here. This is the Scheldt, the river. This is here somewhere what Antwerp is considered Antwerp. And this is one of the many, say, areas, so much in the south, more expensive, as much in the north, cheaper. There's these big redevelopments of these areas, which were formerly industrial areas, were never really much touched because they were close to the highway. They will put the highway on the ground. They will actually fill this part of the dock, and it will become a park. And then a big area here, which was formerly a slaughterhouse area. So this slaughterhouse area is what you can see here, two buildings of the slaughterhouse. One was pitched to a school, and it's supposed to become a school. The other one is still, and it's probably going to be the same school, but not yet developed as such. And then a whole new area in full development, owned by one developer who will make lots of houses there. So here, in some sense, this building is at the same time the catalyst, the organizer, in a way the only open, shared, accessible space of an otherwise, in the future, totally privatized area full of houses, a housing development. So at the same time, the building is already there. It's a beautiful slaughterhouse. It's a building which, in many ways, should simply survive, as you can see it here. But of course, it does not fulfill any of the requirements to become a school. So here, I mean, it's a page of Architecture Without Content of, I think, a few years ago, where we were, contemplating on how, buildings of a certain complexity could acquire, formal coherence. We called it then palimpsest. And of course, one of the most iconic is how the church cuts through the mezquita. Our project is half as radical. But equally so, of course, the CESC Pompeii, with this fantastic building next to the existing cluster of old industrial buildings. I think here, in a way, it's 2023. It's even much more pragmatic. But it's one of the two big halls, is the big hall. We add a tower, which you want to see here. There's a beautiful tree, so we cut our tower a little bit. We inhabit the existing slaughterhouse building by adding one gigantic table. I believe it's visible here. So you see that here we build actually this green table on its own columns in it. I had a version of this presentation where you saw the big table here. It's not here. You have to believe me. This is the hall. The table, in a way, inhabits the space. Below, we take away all the panels, so it becomes all windows. And above, you have this kind of shed light and these perforations through the halls, which we make in the building. So here is the tower, the slaughterhouse, and the cut room. So here you see, in a way, the construction site of that building. You see the old hall next door, which will probably now become phase two of the same school. You see here that, in a way, this hanging facade we kept. We just cut 20 centimeters of the columns, which were always here, like you can see there, so to make the glass pass, but still the building stands. We, like, in a way, drilled all these endless holes, which are windows as much as they are ventilation gaps. So you see it here, there are ventilation and then there are windows. We repaint the roof, we repaint the facade, and we built this tower next to it. So here you see that in mid-construction, all new windows here already, all the perforations of the halls, the new facade below which makes the classrooms, and here this new building which is the extra labs. Actually, there's labs on top with the sheds here, and classrooms in the bottom. So here is the tower, as you can see. And here there is the structure of the table, which we build in. So you see that it has its separate columns, which in a way ignore the structure of the hall itself, because we wanted to keep that hall. That's very beautiful. So the building, the new plate, the table, and the hall are separate entities. They kind of negotiate with each other, but they kind of ignore each other. So the table is there with its round columns. The existing columns are these very beautiful big columns with these cassettes and the big spans. You see that here, the floor with the holes. These are pictures from the last week, I think. So where, in a way, these lab rooms have the light from here, but the holes are not strictly necessary for light, but simply for relationship. And then you have here, that's actually a picture of, I think, 3-4 days ago, when they start to build the paint the facade again, the windows, the roof, and the tower next door, where you see the paneling here, the concrete paneling next to the glass. So the measure system of these windows is the same as the measure system between the columns. I mean, there's plenty of, I think, other stories to tell. So here you see that facade under construction. But I think essentially, of course, is how that house, which was already there, which is the slaughterhouse, I mean, literally so, becomes school and center of development by sheer, in a way, ignorance and embrace all at the same time. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.